Carson Champions League. This is Marcin Dimsch, Filipovic. I'm here with Mick Aquabot Secker. Ties versus Six, so the last match of the day, the last quarterfinal. Are you excited, Aqua?
This is going to be a great match. These two players, I think, are kind of in their prime at the moment as competitive players. Sixo getting a lot of strong wins when joining Na'Vi. And Tice, of course, Europe's champion. Recently winning the Curse Trials as well. So some big wins from both players over the last kind of 6 months. And this is a match I don't think I've ever seen these guys play before.
Oh, really?
In recent times, at least.
I don't recall any specific matches between them, because sometimes, you know, the pro players, they clash in different tournaments. So yeah, you might be right. They maybe haven't played recently, but both great players with different styles. I would consider Sixo being the more aggressive guy, not only because he's playing the aggressive Shaman at the moment, but overall, I think he prefers those fast decks, especially when he grinds on ladder, right? Like, he was the guy who was playing Zoo a lot, and got first place legend on free service at the same time with the Zoo deck. And Tice is mostly a guy who's playing mid-range decks, like Druid, maybe Warrior, Control Warrior, actually. And I mostly connect him with those lines.
There's one thing about Tice that I've noticed recently is he's been picking up Rogue a lot. And like you said, Tice has been someone who's been known to play stuff like Druid. He played Dragon Priest at BlizzCon as well, which is a very mid-range variation of Priest. But recently he's been kind of trying out Rogue a lot, and I like it because he's a very smart player. And Rogue is definitely a deck that if you are good at the game and have very good decision-making, you'll get rewarded for it with a deck like Rogue. So it's nice to see him bring something different, but you were totally right about Sixo. Zulok is kind of a staple. Shaman as well is another one, but also Patron Warrior. Sixo is quite a big Patron Warrior player.
By the way, are you trying to say that Rogue is a rogue deck?
Rogue is a rogue deck? All right, yes. Well, yes, I guess I am. But yeah, but Patron is something Sixo as well is also known for and has been sticking with even after the nerf.
Yeah, absolutely. This matchup overall is, I think, in favor of Rogue. Like, Rogue is kind of like, Shaman. So this basically, Shaman is really similar to Face Hunter, which means that it can just rush Rogue down before Rogue can set up a board or before it can, like, set up anything and defend itself. And normally Rogue is not known for having a lot of heals. Sometimes there's a healbot, one healbot, almost no taunts, maybe one Belcher. But overall, if Shaman has a good opening, and I think Sixo has a decent one, this game can end really fast.
Yeah, Sixo's hand is what he wants in the early game as he faces Shaman. You want to have minions, you put on a lot of life pressure with them, make them use their health as a resource, slam all the removal, and then eventually you just draw into stuff like Doomhammer, Crackles, Lava Bursts, and there's just nothing they can do. You just do like 20 damage from hand, like it's nothing. And yes, Sixo is in a fine position. Tunnel Trog is a brilliant pickup as well. But I do like this line of play. Drop that Flame Tongue Tone down, smack him in the face for 5. So, oh, he's actually clearing.
Yeah,
oh, of course. Yeah, you're going to clear at this point.
I think he can clear because he got lucky with the totem. But now Tice, like, he really wanted some totem to protect his dude or protect the Flame Tongue Totem. But Tice was able to get the backstab now. So with the backstab, if he goes for Azrael backstab on the taunt, he can clear the Flame Tongue with the weapon attack, and then the free one totem golem will not contest the Drake.
Another thing to consider as well is he wants to keep his Blade Flurry for the Feral Spirits.
Oh yeah, you're right.
So he could have Blade Flurried that whole board and been pretty happy, but he wouldn't have a minion down. And Feral Spirits would still be an issue later on. So it was very smart of Tice to kind of hold on. He did have another Deadly Poison, so he could have used that weapon to clear the totem. But if you're going to Blade Flurry, you might as well just leave that totem up.
So a Sixo, you do expect the Flurry to come down at some point. How do you play around it? And by the way, Dr. Boom, is it a stable card in Shaman? I haven't seen it in many Shamans before.
I wouldn't say it is, but it's just that card you can throw in any deck and it will just surprise people. And Like you said, every deck that's being played now can be potentially a new one that hasn't been seen in this tournament because they could have changed their decks. So throwing in a surprise like Dr. Boom can always be a good way to catch your opponent off guard.
Because one of the cards that's really important in the deck is Doomhammer. Whenever Shaman gets an access to the Doomhammer, it can deal so much damage just going through the empty field. But now Tice has that Flurry. Is there any reason not to use it?
I don't think so. Teacher Flurry seems pretty nice. Get a 3-5 down, get the 1-1 token, clear the board, and you're at 24 health on turn 5, so you haven't taken too much life pressure at this point. The Shaman generally wants him to be around 15 at this point.
Yeah, and 6-0 is shaking his head. He knows that this is a really tough situation here. He'll not be able to play Dr. Boom next turn. He will be overloaded, and he has only 4 mana. So what do you even do? Just horse rider face?
Or horse rider face? I don't know. It's tough. Boom.
So horse rider face it is.
The problem is if you clear the teacher, you're not doing any damage to face and you're giving the rogue too much time to be able to put pressure on you. Because this is the point in the game where Tice will start dealing his own amount of pressure and then 6-0. We'll have to use his removal as resource, his spells as removal and not face damage. So I think 6-0 is just identifying here that if he's going to win this game, he just needs to keep pressuring the face. And that Farseer is going to slow him down so much.
Yeah, Tice is going for a bit of a slower turn where he's just developing some minions. But in his hand, the Deadly Poison and Tinker is so much damage in the course of 2 turns. So he can be safe here. He can play safe. Like normally, a Shaman doesn't have much removal. Lightning Storm is a rarity, and something like how's the card called? The 3-mana overload, the Elemental Distraction.
Elemental Distraction. Yeah.
So some people play it in the Shaman deck, but with Dr. Boom, 6-0 had to cut something.
Yeah, I mean, what do you cut? I mean, I think the Shaman list is quite tight with all its damage spells, but Dr. Boom is actually going to be able to do a little bit here. At least force Tice to make some decisions, maybe make some trades, slow him down a little bit, and allow 6-0 to pick back up. But he lost so many minions already, just like Blade Flurry and trading. He might just be out of steam. We'll have to see. A Doomhammer will definitely change everything, but I think that's one of the only cards that will do it. I'm ready to learn.
Yeah, like more or less needs something. Draw the cards with the knowledge spell as well, just getting, you know, 2 cards overloading for 2. Because right now Tice is the one who is drawing into something. And he got Eviscerate as well. So I think Tice is in a good position. And that's not only because he has the board, he has a big weapon and cards in hand. That's because he's at 25. So Shaman wasn't able to deal damage before.
And that was super important. 6-0 had the early pressure he needed, but a bit of patience from Tice allowed him to get a nice Blade Flurry clear, and then all his minion threats were just destroyed. And now 6-0's fighting from behind, and now he has to deal with a Violet Teacher with all these 1-1 tokens and a 6-attack weapon that could deal a tremendous amount of damage, even if he develops a board with a Blade Flurry.
Absolutely. So what do you do at 6-0? You can play Flame Tongue and you can play Abusive, Totem Up, try to get something there. You can kill the Violet Teacher, and even though the weapon is doing a lot of damage, it's still only 6. And if you kill this board, or like most of it, Tice has only 1 card in hand. So being 6-0, you hope it's not a sprint.
Of all the cards, please don't be a sprint. Oh wait, it's a sprint. But yeah, I think you do clear the teacher at this point. You have to play defensively. You can't really you can't just go on the super aggressive because you don't have the Doomhammer to back you up. He can probably ignore the 1-1s, just go face here. But yeah, sprint is going to recharge Tice's hand, and a Blade Flurry would be absolutely awesome. You'd just be able to clear the board.
So sprint to Blade Flurry?
Or into happy times.
I think you have to, right? Like, if you just Acai, does it do much? Not really. You cannot even combo Acai here. So, yeah, sprint. See what you get. So
many options. Yeah, even an Eviscerate wouldn't be too bad. You could clear the totem. use the 1/1s then to clear the two minions, and you just leave the spell power totem up, which kind of sucks.
You got but Prep Fan.
Prep Fan does it as well.
Yeah, it's pretty nice. So we can attack with two dudes into the totem, the Flame Tongue, and then Prep Fan, because the bomb is going to go somewhere. See what you draw.
I'm not sure if there was more value in clearing. I mean, the Flame Tongue Totem does create some problems, but the Spell Power Totem is something you never want to leave up.
There are charged creatures as well.
Yeah, we've seen one Horse Rider so far, that's true.
Alright, but Sixo is not dead yet. Pearl Spirit is something, and he's getting 6 damage to face, putting Tyus on 12. There is a Sludge Belcher, though.
Yeah, Sludge Belcher is going to be a nice way to stop Sixo in his tracks. He can Belcher into SI, clear up one of the Dogies with a token. And I wouldn't use your health at this point to try and clear Wolves, but the Belcher will be able to slow him down at least. Is there anything else you could do?
Not much.
Maybe a sap?
You can sap if you want to slow Sixo down, because Sixo will be overloaded for 4, so he only has, 6 mana. And you'll need to draw into Ancestral Knowledge to get 2 cards, and then into Lava Shock, I guess, to free the mana and maybe still use it. Sixo is in a tough spot. And he's the problem he has is that he's really low on health at the moment, so if Tyus just continues pressuring, he might kill Sixo before he has a second turn. Like, Sixo would need 2 turns to win this, at least, and get perfect draws. He might just get this one extra turn, that's it.
Yeah, I don't think he's going to last much longer. We talk about how much burst Shaman has, but Rogue has tremendous amounts of burst as well. With that sprint in hand, it won't be hard for him to find an Eviscerate, but there's a lot of damage. Well, there's lethal on board and with the weapon, and Sixo sees it, not having what he needs to close out that game, and Tyus takes a 1-0 lead.
Yeah, that was, I think, a good matchup for Sixo, so unfortunate for him that he wasn't able to pull it through. But he has those aggressive decks, so he still has a good chance to go through. Maybe there will be one deck from Tyus that will not be able to win versus aggressive lineup. I assume it's aggressive lineup, because he was playing aggressive decks before.
Yeah, I mean, we know Sixo well enough from his kind of history in the competitive scene. He likes aggressive decks. I'd be surprised if it was Reno Lock or anything else. Zulok is a deck he's had a lot of experience with, but then I just eat my own words because I see an Acidic Swamp Ooze and a Faceless Manipulator. So, Sixo, I'm sorry. You are running Vino. You're not just going to play Zoo. But...
Yeah, look at those hands. They both have the Swamp Ooze and they both have the Faceless, which means this is a Reno Lock mirror match, Aqua. Are you ready for that?
A Reno mirror match which involves bursting from hand probably, so yeah. This is going to be a crazy match, and Alex Strage has been shown up in Reno Lock quite a lot recently. It's an interesting addition, just try and secure that win with the combo, very much kind of like Freeze Mage does, puts him down to 15 and you just do 20 damage from hand. But yeah, this is going to be this very much will depend on who gets Forest in first, I think.
That's one of the things, and the other, I think, is overall board control, because if they have access to Burst in the form of Arcane Golem with Power Overwhelming, maybe something like Hellfire and Dark Bomb, so if one player actually gets access to the board control with Twilight or with Dr. Boom, and gets enough damage on the other without Reno being drawn, he can just burst his opponent down. So for now, I think it will be all about the board control. Whoever takes the board will have an advantage and force the other player to be defensive.
I mean, Tyus does have access to some AoE, but Twilight Drake is a minion that's not going to be affected by that. Sylvanas is another one, Dr. Boom. As it stands, Sixo probably has the better mid-game hand going forward. Tyus has the better late game, I suppose. I mean, he does have a Twist in Never in the back ready. But if things get a little bit too out of control on board, but like you were saying, with Burst available on both sides, I'd be curious if Twist in Never might not find play. It very much depends on what's drawn.
It's funny how Reno plays out in this matchup specifically with the Burst, because if they have access, if they lifetap a lot and if they have access to this combo with Arcane PO which is what, like 8, 16 damage with faces, right? If they have access to that. Reno might not be the best. You lose your whole turn almost, and you still get them being damaged by the minions on board. It might be a lifesaver as well sometimes. So we'll see. Like, I really wonder what role will Reno play in this matchup specifically.
Another thing to consider as well is these players don't know they're running combo variations yet. They could be running the demon variation, which has become quite popular. There's the Fugue and Stalag is a bit outdated now, but some players might still like it and play it. So unless, I mean, I'm sure these two guys will be thinking it could be potentially has combo, so I will play around it. Well, but actually, there's no information here.
Do they even know what they are running? Like, so one played the Voidwalker, tapped, played Implosion, and played the Dark Peddler. And the other did play the Twilight Drake. So, from Tice's perspective, does Sixo know that this is the Reno lock from Tice? And does Tice know that this is the Reno lock from Sixo?
Oh, man. Lack of information, right? I mean, there are cards that will come down in the near future which will give that information, but it's how you play your turns up until then. What do you play around? What are you afraid of? You may be afraid of cards that don't even exist in the deck, but yeah. A Dark Bomb is enough to tell you that this is probably Reno at this point.
Yeah, I think they can assume that, especially Sixu can assume that Tice is playing something different in the zoo. Dark Bomb is probably saying, hey, this is not a zoo deck. So this has to be something different, but you had a Dark Peddler. So I think Sixo at this point knows that Tice is running a Reno lock. And from Tice's perspective, there was a Twilight Drake and Dark Peddler. Does it say Reno?
Could be Handlock, but I think a Shredder. I mean, even a Shredder, it could be mid-range zoo lock, but...
No, I think it's Reno, like most... I mean, like, we know it's Reno, but from Tice's perspective, I would see those cards, I would say it's probably Reno.
Yeah. And so how do you approach... So you figure out it's Reno lock. Now you need to figure out what type of Reno lock it is.
Yeah, well, that's the tricky thing. I think you still have to think about the burst anyway, because if you don't... Like, this is the most popular version, the burst one. You can wonder if there's a Leroy or Arcane Golem, but certainly one of those cards will be there in the deck. You don't have to play around Stalag and Fugan, because it's just done. So yeah, I think you just need to go into a Reno control match, where you want to draw a lot of cards, you want to draw your combo parts, you want to play Thorison, as you mentioned, and be ahead.
The one advantage the combo variation has always had over the Fugan Stalag, or say the Demon variation, is you don't know it's the combo variation until the combo hits you. I mean, you could hold off on the Fugan Stalag, they might not even draw them, so there's no guarantee information that it's combo, unless they have to play a Faceless, say on a minion to stay alive, but usually it's a little too late before you've kind of realize that you're already dead, as Kenshiro would say from Fist of the North Star. So.
Oh man, that was. I haven't watched the Fist of the North Star.
Am I showing my age? But again, we're around the same age. Fist of the North Star is awesome. I'd recommend it.
Yeah, it's a pretty interesting anime. All right, so Sylvanas is being dropped to the board, and that's something that's important overall. I don't know if that's not too fast, but he does have Dr. Boom as a follow up, so he wants to bait removal to eat that Sylvanas and then follow up with the big creature afterwards.
Yeah, I mean, like you said earlier on, it's all about the board. And right now, Sixo has the stronger power on board, but Tice still has kind of answers to what's being played at the moment. Sylvanas is awkward. Low-awkward show makes things very interesting.
Such a phase, like, on both players. Tice was like, okay, how do I play around that now?
Like, now what?
Yep, I have a lot of spells in my hand, and I don't want to give any to Sixo, and Sixo's laughing. Sixo's like, okay, that's cool, I will take it.
The thing is, Sixo has Dr. Boom to follow up, so as far as Sixo's concerned, he's just like, yeah, I can just play Dr. Boom, and then you have to give me whatever spell you decide to use to react to that. And so Sixo will ultimately get two copies. And if you think going into the next turn, Twist and Never is the perfect response to a Dr. Boom, for example.
Yeah, but you don't have to play Dr. Boom this turn, I believe, being 6-0, because exactly of Twisting Never, that's a possibility. So maybe just go for Implosion on one of the Imps and Dark Bomb the 3-3. Kill the second Imp with Sylvanas. Because this would be kind of the board you want to Twisting Nether, and you protect your Lord Walker Cho. So you're good. I think this is a troll board, but it's actually pretty good.
Well, he does go for the tap over. I quite liked what you said with the Dark Bomb play.
It's similar. The thing is, like, you protect the Cho and build up a board that wants to be removed. But this can be removed with just... Demon Wrath, no, not Demon Wrath, but Hellfire.
And you give 6-0 Hellfire, but does it really mean that much, ultimately?
No, I don't think so. Giving him Twisting Nether would be much more devastating.
I mean, yeah, I think you just have to kind of bite the bullet here and give him the Hellfire. But what do you play after that? I mean, you don't have any minions.
Do you even want to silence Lord Walker Cho? Oh, not really.
Goes to the Demon Wrath instead. I guess the Demon Wrath is less effective than Hellfire because you can't use it as damage to, like, finish off your opponent. And not only that, of course, both players run demons, so I guess it's the less efficient card to give to 6-0 for Lord Walker Cho.
Yeah. But now 6-0 can go Dr. Boom. Kidding about Demon Wrath. Two copies! What? Reno! Will it work?
Double Demon Wrath! Yeah,
giving Demon Wrath is a good thing because you're not giving your opponent more burst. And this is about everything. Like, this match is about board control, it's about burst, it's about card advantage as well. So that's why I think that was good from Dice's perspective. But now do you just... there is no Big Game Hunter here. You can Siphon Soul Dr. Boom. You don't have to Twisting Nether yet.
Yeah, I think I was just thinking what would be better. I think I prefer Siphon Soul. Because you can tap again then and dig deeper into the... Oh, let me count the cards too. No, you can't tap again. But, you know, I think, like you said, keep and hold of your Twisting Nether. You might as well, because he's going to develop another board eventually, and that's just a clean response to it.
There's still no Arcane Golem for 6-0, so Alexstrasza is a big minion you can play on board, especially after he's seen Siphon Soul. But you don't get a chance to burst yet. But on the other hand, if Alexstrasza survives, you'll be in a great shape, and you have the silence for a possible taunt.
But you're also telling Tice, I might have the burst in my hand. You know, this might be a way to get Tice to, say, use Reno if he had it. But he doesn't have access to that. He doesn't even have access to Dr. Boom. So he may feel a Twist and Never might be needed at this point.
I wonder if Tice would just go for Lothab, Sludge Belcher. And then 6-0 can respond with Iron Bigao, and he will still have 8 mana for something. But... no lethal. He'll be at 5, 30, 1 damage off with PO. But if he gets Arcane Golem, will that be enough? Not enough mana. Oh man.
It's looking like Lothab Belcher seems like the best play to lock out potential burst from hand. It looks like Tice agrees as well.
There is a chance with the bomb lethal. If he goes, because he will be able to Iron Beak and Power Overwhelming.
And there's Arcane Golem.
Yeah, but he will not be able to fit that in. He only has 2 mana floating, so... that will be 12. So he will need to hit face with for 2. He might actually go with the bomb right now. Just attack with the bomb. And if the bomb lands on face, like 2 damage, you just win.
Possibilities. You might as well take the risk at this point. Because even if you don't win this, if you don't win this turn, Tice still needs a way to deal with Alex. But not only that, he needs the heal as well. Because now 6-0's sitting on a lot of burst damage. 6-0's going for the silence first. All right, is he going to go for the bomb?
He can still go for Power Overwhelming on the bomb, and.
Ooh, all right, so that's
he missed there. Okay, sure.
So do you hit face or do you clear? I think you just clear minions at this point.
Yeah, well, if there is no Reno, like even if there is a Reno, like there is only 4 mana remaining, so you'll have to do something like a Shadow Flame. There is still, is there a Shadow Flame open here? Like, can you Shadow Flame something?
You could PO the Lofab.
You can faceless Alexstrasza if you really want to and Shadow Flame that, but you will lose some burst you have.
If you, this is tough. Like, you kind of need to copy the Sludge Belcher to stay alive.
True.
Or at least try to, but you can't. Yeah. So you copy the Sludge Belcher.
Yeah, that's all right.
And then you Shadow Flame after you hit.
But the problem is like you're selling your burst, so you did clear the board quite nicely. But now, is there free damage that he needs to clear this Belcher and then just deal 3 more damage to face? How can he do it? He can PO Belcher and then Big New Hunter, that's 4 mana.
Seven. Man, that Belcher's a problem.
Oh man, is there lethal? He's missing 1 mana, I think. So if you... Can you clear the Belcher and the token as well? Like, you need Dark Bomb for... Okay, so you need Dark Bomb for 1-2. And then you need Arcane Golem and PO to win, which is 4-6 mana. And you have only 4 mana open. Was there an option to kill? No, not really.
This is really efficient way of dealing with most of it, at least. I mean, he has a board of 1-1s now. Forces Tice to start clearing stuff. Or at least Reno in to stay alive, and if these tokens are going to get dealt with, the 1-2 is not going to stick around very long, and then we have the burst combo in hand.
Yeah, absolutely. I was just looking for sneaky lethals, but Sixo is in absolute control of this game for now, and he has the combo in his hand. So this is Arcane Golem with PO 16 damage there, and he can easily deal with the 1-1 taunt.
And Tyson's not too happy, although he accepts his fate. And he's going to tie a 1-1 with Sixo. So this is what I kind of expected from these two players in this match. It's going to be very back and forth. I wouldn't be surprised if it's a 3-2. But I said that last time and it was a 3-1. So I don't want to curse any player here.
Yeah, anything can happen. But looking at the matchups, the Reno lock will stay for Tyson. If Shaman faces that, Shaman should struggle versus Reno Lock unless it gets a God Hand. If it doesn't get a God Hand, Reno Lock should normally, with a normal draw, just... if it gets Reno, right? Like, stop the burst early, get maybe to 15, and then slam Reno and just win right there. Shaman versus Druid has a chance to win. So I think it's kind of like a 50-50. What do you think about Shaman versus Druid?
Gul'dan! I think it's a 50-50 as well, just because Druid can just snowball out of control with the ramp and just put too much pressure on the board. But Shaman, again, is another class that can snowball out of control with early Eternal Trogs. What do you think? Patron Reno Lock is... I've had many opinions on what this matchup should be. What do you think it is? Do you think it's in the Reno Lock's favor?
I think Reno Lock has a lot of... clear potential, and it should be able to win this, especially because if you look at this matchup from the perspective of the old Patron versus Handlock could die if there was Warsong before nerf, but after the nerf Handlock got better and better, and Reno Lock should be able to deal with the board, so I think it's in favor of Reno Lock. What do you think about it?
Well, Trump, when I was talking to Trump about this, Trump believes that it's in Reno's favor, and heavily in Reno's favor.
Yeah.
Sotl, on the other hand, feels it's more even, because the AoE clears of the Reno lock are far more situational, because they're only one-offs. And of course, like, Shadow Flame needs an activator, Hellfire's a clean way, Twist and Never is a very expensive way, and might not even get play. So, one thing, I believe Sotl was saying, that if Patron plays the tempo game and just plays aggressively, they can bring it to kind of a 50-50. But I believe it's in Reno's favor mainly because the heals definitely swing things out of range for the warrior, but it does depend on drawing those hellfires, those shadow flames, like key moments where the warriors develop those patron boards. So it can kind of swing buff. I can see why he thinks it's 50-50 because it's very circumstantial for both players of what they need to win the game. Yeah, and there's absolutely a Hellfire.
There is a Hellfire. And overall, I think Reno Lock can also go for a sustain game where you just respond to all the threats from Patron. But even though Reno Lock can have an advantage, let's look at those hands overall. So 6-0. He has Deathspite, he has Whirlwind, he has Patrons, and he has Dr. Boom. He also has Big Game Hunter for a possible Molten Giant if it shows up somewhere along the way. So he has a lot of great tools and a really good hand. What do you think about Reno Locks?
So he has the AoE clear, which we were talking about. He does have some taunt as well with Sun Fury. And he does have Reno Jackson. But we're at a point now where Sixo has put him down to 14 health already. So we're probably going to see a Reno come down next turn if he's not careful. And this Acidic Swamp Ooze Demon Wrath play is absolutely brilliant.
Yeah.
Clears the board and clears the weapon.
It stops the patrons from showing up. And then you just open the way for either Reno or Thorison, where if you feel like you're not threatened on board, and Patron, how much burst can Patron really generate? Like, you have no charge either. You only have Grommash, but on turn 6, Grommash will not be an option. And you can have a weapon, but there's like a certain amount of damage you can pack. Maybe double Enrage if you really want to play around that. But if he feels there is not enough damage on this board, he might just slam Thorison here instead.
I mean, even if he had like Crocon Elite and double Inner Rage, he still wouldn't be able to kill him. And now Tice drops the Thorison, and now things start to swing in Tice's favor a lot more.
He already has the combo, by the way. He did pick up the Faceless. So he has the 6 mana combo for 16 damage.
Yep, that's a lot of damage as well. So once Tice sustains the board, it'll be a turn or two before Tice can close out the game with just the combo. He can heal back to full, he can lock out spells, he could even play super slow and, like you said, kind of drag the game out and start off with an antique heal bot and then go into Reno a lot later. I think at this point, Tice is kind of in the winning position.
Absolutely. But the game is still not over, and even if Tice wins this game, he is left with his druid deck, and then I believe Six will have two good matchups, the Shaman and the Patron Warrior. Like, Shaman might not be the best matchup, but it's okay. It's okay to win versus the Druid. And then Patron has a slight advantage. So we'll see. But back to this game. So do you just think Healbot instead? So
many. Yeah, I quite like Healbot here. You don't need to play Reno. And you only play Reno if you want to drop the 4-6 down.
Maybe top, I mean, first and Reno. What do you think about that?
I think that's fine too. The only reason I'd like to play Reno at this point is because you get the 4-6 body. And it can't be killed at the moment. 6-0 will need a little bit extra from his hand to be able to deal with it. And if it does stick around, you've just picked up an Argus. So that again creates even more. But it looks like Tyze believes that a Lofeb is probably the better option here. Lockout, maybe an Execute, or maybe force him to spend his whole mana using an Execute. So, interesting.
That maybe packs a bit more punch on the board because he was able to put seven damage in. The combo on his side is 6 mana, so not able to go into Alexstrasza is 9. What is he planning there? He needs to deal with his Dr. Boom now because he's still at 11. Unless he actually goes for Reno. He just closes his eyes, goes for face. So Reno for 5 for three manas. What he can play even? Hellfire not really. Not yet.
I think he has two game plans. He can either clear the board and set up Alex next turn and then set up combo. Or he can kind of go the way you said and drop Reno, close your eyes, be super aggressive, 4-6 of the trade. And it looks like he prefers that. Unless he's going to go for the Hellfire and then Reno. I quite like that.
Yeah, that's a good one as well. He can actually die here.
He can.
What?
3. Oh, that was close.
Oh my god, he took that risk. He was like, I'm not going to die the double bombs for for four.
Wow. That was risky, but, you know, look at the reward he got from it. Back to full health. 4-6 on board. Gets Alex next turn. Drop the 8-8. And then he just has the combo in hand ready to win. So, yeah, I think it was worked out pretty well for him.
Yeah. But that one moment was really dangerous. 6-0 getting a nice... Oh, he didn't cast the inner rage here. So, he knows that Hellfire is not coming anymore. Why would you not cast inner rage? Or maybe he ended it. Look at his face. Did he end turn before drawing the card?
I think he did, yeah. He doesn't look impressed. So here, I would like to see Alex come down and just hit the face of Reno. So you're not going to be burst down from 30 at this point. And then you force 6-0 to start trading. If he doesn't armor up or use the armor smith, you should just have lethal.
Yeah, but there is this armor smith, as you say. So, but still, an 8-8 on board. Like, he will need to do something with the Alexstrasza. Not, she doesn't only deal damage. It's still a dragon you need to deal with.
Fortunately for 6-0, he does have the big game hunter sitting there. So he does have a response to that. I guess it depends what he wants to do with the Reno Jackson. Maybe just clear up a patron.
Yeah, I guess. Like, you want to get some value out from it. And also, I think killing the patron conceals the combo a bit. It's like, if you go for face, it's like saying, hey, I want to burst you down right now. But if you kill a patron, it sends a signal to 6-0. It's like, hey, we're still playing the trading game. I'm still in the trading game. I'm all right. I don't have, like, 16 damage in my hand.
We're still playing Hearthstone. Don't worry. No need to panic.
Exactly.
Alright, so he gains one armor so far. If he armors up, he does get out of range, right?
Yeah, he will be at 18, and Thais will need to get something like a Dark Bomb to finish things off, or Dark Peddler into some more damage, because at the moment he has 16.
Gets off a two-card Battle Rage now if he wants.
Can 6-0 play the sustain game and actually escape the range with those double armorsmiths? Like, you know, like versus Freeze Mage, basically get so much armor, you're untouchable at some point.
This is the advantage of Leroy instead of Arcane Golem, because Leroy was kind of the first popular version of this deck. VLPS, I think, was one of the kind of inventors of it. Although Arcane Golem lets you not have Forsen, involved in the combo, so you can just combo without him. But if he had the Leroy version, he would have just killed him.
Yeah, that's true. And now Thais is in a bind, like, do you Siphon Soul the Armorsmith? Like, you probably would like to get something like a Shadow Flame, maybe.
Ooh,
Siphon Soul, Armorsmith, and then coil the free one, or coil the free one first.
If you Siphon Soul the Armorsmith, you tell 6-0 you have combo in hand, right?
Yeah, I guess. So you probably need to Siphon Soul the patron, that, like, get it under control. I mean, combo is great if you can win with the combo, but Sabrina Locke has a lot of tools and a lot of great minions overall. Oh, ooh, man.
That feels very bad.
That is terrible. That is absolutely terrible.
And now 6-0 can draw 1, 2, 3, 4 cards just from trading.
That was so close, and suddenly it's going out of Thais' hands. Like, this is just terrible for him. Not only 6-0 is escaping the combo range, so essentially making those three cards dead cards in Thais' hand. Thais doesn't have enough pressure, and Molten Giant maybe he will be able to play it, but 6-0 just getting all the draws. He's in a great position, and no more clears for Thais at this turn. He needs something like a Shadow Flame. And even with the Shadow Flame, he might need to Shadow Flame the Arcane Golem.
But look at 6-0's hand. He just drew most of his deck. So 6-0's going to be able to set up a win condition for next turn now. So Thais is going to need one of these AoE clears to stay in the game. That's a Shadow Flame. That is one way to do it. But Grom in hand.
Yeah, can he survive this?
He can, I think, right?
Yeah, he has Molten Shadow Flame into Belcher. So that's something. Is there a good way to... Actually, wait. Is there a way to deal with the 1-2? Yeah, there is a way to actually survive with the 1-2, because I think Thais will be left on one damage, on one point of health.
You can also heal bot. You could heal bot as well. Arcane Golem, Shadow Flame, if you want to do it that way. But the Molten Giant way is just so much better. How is he going for the heal bot? Over the Belcher here. Oh, it keeps the Armorsmith up.
So much armor.
And yeah. Nice 6-0 is just snowballing at control, like you said. Kind of similar to the Freeze Mage matchup.
Yeah, 6-0 has everything he needs at the moment. He has two executes. Just one execute at the giant. He doesn't even need to go for Grom this turn. He can ask the question again, like, play the patrons, get the Whirlwind patron, and be like, alright, I've seen Hellfire, I've seen Shadow Flame, do you have Twisting Nether? And still try to set up Lethal for next turn, if there is no response to this board.
I mean, you could even drop the Frovin as well, put even more pressure on.
Yeah.
There's a lot of ways he can do this. He doesn't even need to use his Death Spite at this point, potentially. I mean, no, he could use his Death Spite. He can use Slam on Grom next turn if he needs to activate him.
Yeah, exactly. So what do you do? Do you attack face with Armorsmith for one, then you play Patron, then you attack face with the Death Spite, then you Whirlwind, and you play Frodding somewhere along the way, right?
No.
What I'm wondering is, what's 6-0 worried about?
He might just be trying to sequence it correctly, because there's also the Courser, and you might want to use the weapon, and he needs to count like how much damage you want to put in your opponent. This is a very difficult turn for him, and time is running out. Will he be able to actually play everything he wants?
Oh, he's going for it. Execute comes down. Could armor up as well, just to push Tice out a little bit further.
Yeah. Alright, everyone, get in here. There's only two dudes, but still, at the moment, Tice doesn't have a response to that. He has the Siphon Soul. He can Siphon Soul one. And he needs something. Like Twisting Nether?
Like Twisted Nether, that's definitely a way to deal with this. So you Twisted Nether for 8. Do you play Arcane Golem and just hit face? Just try and do something?
If there is a weapon, no, you cannot play Arcane Golem, really. But on the other hand, it's so much health on 6-0. Like, from Tice's perspective, to win this game, he needs to just kill all the things that 6-0 has on board, overall. Like, he just needs to respond to every threat and take this game to fatigue, kind of. He still has some threats in the deck, I believe, but so has 6-0. So it will be really tough for Tice to come back with just a combo hand.
Especially with the health 6-0 has as well, like, how do you even begin to chip away at that health as a combo Reno Lock, not as kind of like a more demons-orientated or as Fugan Stalag-orientated? And the problem is, like, this Belcher, like, how does he deal with this? He Siphon Souls it, but then how does he deal with Grom? Like, there's just not enough ways for Tice to deal with the pressure 6-0 is putting on right now.
Absolutely. So, this game... I thought Tice has it. Tice had the combo, Tice had everything. The Thought Torison was so strong, and the Reno as well. But this is the magic of the Patron deck. 6-0 was still able to turn it around, and it was beautiful. I mean, the game is not over yet, but looking at the situation, like 6-0 having all the birds and Reno gone from the equation, it would be tough for Tice.
There was a moment in this game where Tice played the Implosion on that patron, and 6-0 drew 8 cards, I think it was, or something ridiculous, of double Battle Rage. I mean, that was definitely the turning point, which put Tice out of the game completely. I mean, I know he's been fighting hard to get back in, but once a patron draws 8 cards and just can just do what he wants, I mean, how do you... You're just playing too reactive, and with all the health gain he gained from those Armorsmiths, I don't know how Tice can win, really. Unless he has, like, Jiraxxus and can just generate tokens. 6-6 tokens all the time. But I don't think he'll have that in the deck, especially with Alex.
Yeah, he had Alex Straza. So now he is saying, okay, I will not use the combo anymore. I will not use the faces. I'm trying to get some value with good minions. And 6-0 is getting Inner Rage. Is there some lethal that's available here for 6-0. If he attacks, maybe there's a lethal with Frodding Berserker. Can Frodding actually deal enough damage? There is a Whirlwind, there is an Execute, and there is an Inner Rage as well. So if you go Grom into one of the free fives, you do Whirlwind, the one of them dies, and then you can kill the 1-2 with... Actually you can attack with the second 1-3, then Whirlwind, so the 1-2 will die. And then the last guy will have 3-2, 1-2. Oh man, I think it's... maybe there is a way. Maybe 6-0 will find it. Like, I'll have to think about it more. Can he find lethal here?
There's a lot going on here to be able to get the lethal. And he doesn't have much time. Let's see if he's figured it out. It's quite a puzzle, really.
He should have whirlwind it first, I think. Unless he goes... He might miss some damage here. And he will not have enough time to finish this off.
Oh, he didn't finish it.
Yeah, he didn't have enough time. So 6-0 is really devastated by this. He just got wrecked by time. But this is a really cool lethal puzzle. I think there was a chance to actually get lethal here.
What can Tice do in response here? Is this an opportunity for Tice to get back in this game?
Let's see if he can actually clear, right? I think it might be. Because if he goes for... Siphon Soul, can he kill both Grom and Frodding Berserker? That's the biggest question.
I don't think he can.
Oh man, but he can actually defend Vargas.
That Belcher is creating a lot of problems for Tice.
6-0 is just dying there. 6-0 is like, how could I do this? No, just didn't have enough time. Alright, so you Siphon Soul one of the targets. You Siphon Soul, let's say, Frodding Berserker because it has more potential, right? So you Siphon Soul that, and then you you attack into the 3-3 with the 3-3. You play Arcane Golem. Or maybe just even, like, Defender of Argus to have a, on your 1-2 to have a 2-3.
He's just going for Shredder here. I think he's just hoping that 6-0 doesn't have a way to deal with this 1-2.
Well, he actually has a way, but still, it's not lethal yet. He can slam face for 10 and play some board. But if Dice clears this and survives, then he will have a chance to maybe win still. Like, he's not taking fatigue damage yet, and 6-0 has nothing else.
Oh, what can he draw? Peddler? Soulfire?
Yeah, I guess. So he can kill... Like, he needs to get rid of the Grommash or just toned up stuff, right? So Peddler is okay because it's a minion that he can tone up. And he can tone up with the 4-3 as well.
It's a Soulfire.
There is a Soulfire and a Mortal Coil. What does that change? He can Soulfire Grom. And he then can... coil it. Oh, no, he cannot... Oh, man.
So he can clear... So he can use Arcane Golem here. So he can clear the one with the Soulfire. So he can powerful whelm the old Arcane Golem. He can clear the 3-3 with Soulfire. He can clear the 1-2 with the Shredder, then run the Arcane Golem into Grom.
Yeah.
And then 6-0 has nothing. And he's on fatigue. I know that Tice is low, but if he doesn't discard Dr. Boom, I don't think Dr. Boom even matters at this point.
Well, it's, he will have minions, right? Like, we still don't know exactly what 6-0 has in the deck, but, we know what 6-0 has in the deck. He has nothing. What Tice is in the deck? Like, how many cards does he have?
Wow.
6-0 just conceded, but was that actually, how many cards Tice had?
He must have had at least 5 to 6.
Okay. All right. Wow, but that match was just crazy good. Was that lethal? I still don't know. I think there was something, but this is a great Reddit puzzle, right?
I think it was lethal. I don't think 6-0 would have went for it unless it was lethal. But he may have figured it out a little bit too late. And it wasn't an easy puzzle to solve. I mean, there was a lot of kind of Sludge Belch interaction to go into. And, you know, when those Sludge Belches pop open, that takes time. And maybe that he didn't take into account the time that that would take. And cost him the game, unfortunately.
So, if he goes with All right, like I'll just need to revisit that. I have to know if he really messed it up, and it seems like he did. He just didn't have enough time. But now we're back with the Druid versus Patron. So overall, a slight advantage to Patrons, especially if they can go Death Spite into Grim Patron to something. But on the other hand, Tyus has an okay opening with Innervate Coin and Thorizon.
Yeah, but 6 hours good hand too. You know, he's got that Death Spite ready for the Grim Patron. It will also make the Dread Corsair a lot cheaper. So if 6-0 does find an Inner Rage, things will be very tough for Tyus, because having that Inner Rage Death Spite Patron combo on 5 can be absolutely devastating for the Druid.
I was just looking at 6-0 and I wonder how much mental damage he took by not killing Tyus with that in that situation and getting punished for that and losing that match. Tyus going for Innervate Pilot Shredder instead of keeping those for Thorizon. So he decides he wants to have more pressure on board already instead of just going for a big Thorizon turn.
It's a nice turn for Tyus as well. Gets a Wrath on the Big Game Hunter. And then you can just clear the Armorsmith and keep that Shredder around if you want to go that route.
Keeper might be better, actually. Or is it? If he goes Coin Keeper, kills the 4-2 with a Keeper. First attacks into Armorsmith. He has 2 minions on board. And Wrath is quite good versus Patrons overall. So if you have that those minions and you have pressure, but he will not have anything on turn 4, only Wrath. And that's a tough turn.
I think that turn does actually play nicer looking at 6-0's hand, because if he plays Death Spite into Dreadcoaster, then you just have the Wrath on turn 4. So this might actually line up quite nicely for Tyus based on if 6-0 plays a Dreadcoaster or not.
Alright, so he goes for... I think he will play Dreadcoaster here just to block an attack. Like, it's a minion that blocks the Shredder. But on the other hand, Do you really Wrath? Like, Wrath is super needed for the Patrons, so he might actually consider just attacking with the 4-2 into the 3-3 and then playing Aspirant.
Yeah, I suppose so. Although, if you Wrath this, you force a Death Spite onto potentially your Pilot Shredder or your Aspirant, and then your Shredder will be able to do the same thing that Wrath does anyway, if he does commit Patrons this turn.
You're right. No Inner Rage for 6-0, so this means if he goes for the Patron, it's not ideal.
So do you clear something, then play Belcher? Or do you keep the Axe for the Patron? I mean, I think you want to keep this Axe around for now, but leaving the Aspirant up will let Tyus play Thorizon if he wants.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, this is a tough turn. Maybe you can just slam the Aspirant and go with your weapon into Shredder. Okay, so he hopes there is no Thorizon. So he's trying to prepare himself, like force Tyus to attack with either Hero Power or both minions into Belcher. And he hopes there is nothing big coming on turn 6. And you know, like, turn 6 for Druid is mostly Thorizon, sometimes Sylvanas, but most of the time it's just a 5 drop. Like, they do not have that many 6 drops.
Yeah, he looks like he's decided with Thorizon. I was just thinking, is Druid of Claw maybe a little bit better? Because it tanks the weapon. But I know, I think just getting Thorizon down now and forcing him to use that Death Spite might be better overall. Because once that Aspirant goes, he wouldn't be able to play Ancient of Lore next turn. So if he does clear the Aspirant this turn, at least he can drop the Ancient of Lore next turn with the Thorizon coming down.
Yeah, I think Thorizon was just amazing from Tyus. And it was great. It's dealing damage. It's putting 6-0 lower. Right now, Tyus is the one with initiative, with more minions that have to be cleared. And 6-0 still not finding the second whirlwind effect to go with the Patrons. He'll have to decide how to protect the Belcher, maybe. So if he slams Thorizon, he might maybe like slam on the 2-3, then slam, see what he draws, attack into maybe even Shredder. Oh, he's going for the Patrons because they will be protected by the Belcher and he can still execute. Alright, interesting.
I mean, he can still clear the Aspirant with the Belcher and the Belcher's going to stick around on 2 health. And that might just be enough at this point.
Not even executing to not face something like a Doomsayer.
So now Tice's turn is a little bit more difficult. He doesn't have any spells to offer his removal for these patrons. He might just need to drop the 5/5 body and just draw some cards and just try and find answers next turn. And that's not a great minion to get for, from the Shredder from Tice's perspective, because now he can generate an extra patron.
Yeah, so instead of going for Lothub, he will need to draw the cards and draw into those valuable cards that something like basically combo to be able to push and then clear, or maybe combo innervate. But for now, we can see why this matchup is good for the patron player. 6-0 can draw a lot of cards. He can deal with his board easily and extend his board as well.
Yep, he can slam his own patron. So he draws one card from that, and then he's going to draw four cards from Battle Rage, followed by he can run his 1-2 into the 5/5 and execute that if he wants to do it that way, or he can just even run the 3-2 patron. He's got an Inner Rage as well for an extra patron, could play Armorsmith. So much he could do at this point.
Do you want to play Frauding? Like Frauding, Inner Rage, the patron, which is the 3-2, attack into the 5/5, attack for 1 with the taunt. With this you protect possible patrons. Shouldn't be too hard on a possible swipe. You are having a lot of minions on board though.
Yeah, I quite liked playing the Frauding at that point, because it would become, what, a 5-4? And then that can challenge in another Agent of Law. It can challenge a Lothub. It would only need and one more damage interaction to kill a Druid of the Claw. But it looks like 6-0 wanted to go for more card draw. Maybe if he thinks that Tice has like a way to swipe this board, he might just force him to draw cards.
Yeah, swipe and wrath will deal with the patrons, but Tice has neither. So what he can maybe do is Living Roots the 1-2, then Druid of the Claw charges one the 3/3s. And that will be 5 mana, so he can hero power one of the 3 ones.
Yeah. You can't just leave this around, right? This board. Going for a Lothub, it seems, just to lock out any potential whirlwind effects coming up. It doesn't lock out execute, so 6-0 does have that available to him if he wants it. But things are looking pretty shaky for Tice at the moment.
Yeah, especially with the Armorsmith. Tice had a chance to maybe leave that shade of Naxxramas to grow and then win with the combo and maybe even with Living Roots. Basically win with damage, but with the Armorsmith, 6-0 will be able to just deal with this board easily and get some health in the process as well.
I mean, he could even not use an execute here. He could drop, say, Frauding Berserker and then run the 3-1 patron into him. Generate a threatening Frauding Berserker to go with the patrons, which are also posing a massive threat. And again, how does Tice come back from this as a Druid player? No hard removals like Twist and Nevers available to him. It's not looking good.
Yeah, absolutely. And I like that how 6-0 is taking his time. It seems like he calmed down. He's not remembering the whiff that he had in the last game. And he's taking his time and just wants to seal this game. He's not rushing. He is calm about it. And he needs that, because if he wins this and he is in a good position to take this game, he'll have the last one in the match, Shaman versus Druid, and that will need a lot of focus from him.
Ancient of Law gonna try and find something to help sustain. Wrath is not enough at this point.
How much damage is there from 6-0 this turn? 6, 7, 10. So Grommash will be one off, I believe. Taskmaster is not bad. Like, 6-0 can just take it slow.
6-0 can do whatever he wants at this point. Which is unfortunate for Tice, because this game's gone out of his control. He's trying his hardest to find some way back into it, but as we know, like, 6-0 has double execute, so anything that becomes too much of a threat can just be dealt with simple one mana spell. He has damage in hand with Cruel Taskmaster. He just picked up another weapon. And he's just generated. Look how much health he's generated.
Yeah, I know, right? So with the Armorsmith, he is absolutely safe and secure. The only thing that he might be concerned about is that he cannot play any more minions. He has 7 on board. It's like, look, he cannot play Frodding. What do you do?
He's used 2 mana, drawn so many cards, cleared an Ancient of Lore, and he has 7 mana to spare, drop a weapon, swing for face. See if Tice has an answer to this, but I don't think he does.
Yeah, this is something you want to do in Hearthstone tournaments, right? When you're in the top 8, fighting for the top 4 spot, just chilling, you know, having this match that cannot be lost, being at 35, knowing what Druid can play. There is a swipe though, so maybe there is a small way to clear this board. Is there? If you do like Living Roots on 1 free-free, and then you swipe, still, not really.
Yeah, there doesn't seem to be a way to do this. Without having Force and hit a lot of these spells. Going for card draw here, just to see if you can find anything. Another Living Roots. Wait, can he...
Yeah, he can actually clear patrons.
Yeah.
That would be 6, 7, 8, 9 damage. Yeah, so I believe he can actually Living Roots into the free tools and then swipe. I can see. Alright, Tyson sees.
Like, doesn't even want to deal with that nonsense right now. Just get into the next game and see if he can get the win. So this series has gone 2-2. So far, like we expected, a 3-2 from players of this caliber. Face Shaman versus Druid. Who's your money on here, Nimsh?
Oh man, Face Shaman versus Druid. So if Face Shaman has a really good opening, it will be hard. I think Face Shaman has an advantage overall in this matchup, because Face Shaman is super stable, super solid in a way that you want to get the one drops and then deal some damage with the minions in the very beginning. And if you do that, you just burst down the Druid and the game ends. And as a Druid, you need to get specific cards that you're mulliganing for. So you need Living Roots, you need Innervate into Keeper, or Innervate into Swipe, or Wild Growth onto and then Keeper, Wrath. Those are the cards you need, so I would give an advantage to Shaman, but looking at Tice's hand, he got those good cards he wanted, or at least some of them.
Yeah, he got quite a few of them, but 6-0 kind of has almost a dream hand. If that Sir Finley was a Tunnel Trog, things would be great, because you could like Tunnel Trog and the Totem Golem to coin Feral Spirit, but he can still do that with the Finley if he chooses. So things are looking pretty nice. He decides to go for the Totem Golem first, which I think I prefer, just because you're going to force a Wrath from your opponent at this point.
Yeah, it's not even forcing Wrath, it's more about asking him, do you even have a Wrath? There is an Innervate, wow, so that's a perfect hand for Tice, more or less. Like, this is exactly what you want. Just cheat in with those free cards and be able to get advantage. So Pilot the Shredder instead that contests the 3-4, and 6-0 is shaking his head because this is exactly what you don't want to see.
I mean, this is Tice taking the initiative on board now, so if 6-0 decides to go face here, this gives Tice an opportunity to Wrath the 3-4, use one of his 1-1s to clear it up, and then the Shredder can take care of the 1-3. And he's stuck with his Shredder on board, which 6-0 is going to have a bit of problem dealing with unless he expends some damage. Oh wow, he does go for the clear here.
Yeah, well, he hopes that there is... Because Tice had a really good opening. Living Roots into Innervate Shredder. So you hope there is no Wrath just coming for you. Or no Shade. You really hope there will be just a hero power here. But we know Tice has a Wrath open. So he can clear the 3-3 with the Wrath. Kill the 1-3 with the 4-3, go for face, and then he has another Shredder on turn 4, so this is beautiful for Tice.
This is the type of hand you need. If you're going to beat the Shaman, you need these sticky minions, which will race the Shaman as well. I mean, 4 damage every turn from each of them is quite a lot once it stacks up. 6-0 might not be able to ignore them, but if he does clear them, they pop another minion out, and then you have to deal with that, so it may just come down to a race at this point.
Yeah, 6-0 is opening his eyes. He's like, he can't believe this. This is literally the worst case scenario for him. And this is mostly why also people are not clear on the Druid matchups. Because if you play Druid, if you get those kinds of hands, you just win versus aggro decks without problems. Like, you dominate them. but if you don't, you lose. Where some decks, they don't have innervates, they have a bit more clear situation where you either get the normal curve and you have a good situation, or you don't and you just lose. With Druid, it's so weird sometimes.
And Tice just keeps having answers. Deals with these Feral Spirits now. 6-0's locked out of 2 mana. He might tap here, but now he's staring down this board, which will just keep clearing the stuff that 6-0 throws down. He can't even use the Argent Horse Rider, and if he could, I mean, it's not going to be able to do much. He goes for the Rock Biter, so now 6-0's in a situation where he has to start clearing minions with his damage spells, and that's not what you want to do. Like, you want to be the aggressor, which he hasn't had the opportunity to do yet.
Yeah, well, in a sense, he could be doing that because he has lifed up, so he can play the value game versus Druid, which is obviously counterintuitive because you want to go for face, but this is a terrible situation. Fortunately for him, that Abusive can actually clear the 4-4, so you can just use a Horse Rider and go into it. It's 4 mana though, but it's something, and he decides to crackle instead.
Oh, we get to 6 as well. So he does deal with the Drake, and again, a crackle's being used to clear the board. They're the cards you want to go face, and that's one of the most dynamic cards in the Shaman's arsenal, being able to do 6 damage. Tice could potentially just play a Druid of the Claw now, and then 6-0 has to find another damage spell or more damage to deal with that 6 health. Things are looking really good for Tice at the moment.
Absolutely. I think actually Shapeshift and Pilot the Shredder is a bit better. Just deal with the minion, because we've seen something like Flametongue Totem coming from 6-0. And at this point, Tice, because he knows he has Dr. Beaumont in 7, he can just go for it. For simple, honest play, where 6-0 is basically behind. The buffs won't work, he won't have the minions. And he is in the end, he is a Shaman deck. And Shaman without board has a tough situation.
There's that Flametongue Totem, which we were talking about. It's good he cleared up that Argent Horse Rider. Uses another Rockbiter weapon to try and fight for board. Uses Lava Shock as well, so that's 2 Rockbiters, a Crackle, and a Lava Shock, and a Tempo Abusive Sergeant, just to stay in this game. And Tice has Dr. Boom coming down this turn. Or Ancient of Law if he fancies it, but he's at 27 health on turn 7. How does an Aggro Shaman win this game?
Will 6-0 just concede here? There is a Savage Roar coming in, so with the Savage Roar, that's it, and 6-0 knows this is over, Tice knows this is over, we know this is over, and this is in fact over.
And Tice is going to be the final player who's going through to the top 4 tomorrow. He will be joining Oskaka, Ekop, Pavel, so those 3 players have already gone through, and of course Tice will be making the last player there. So Oskaka Ekop will be our first game tomorrow, I imagine, followed by Pavel Tice. So, you know, we've had some really good games today. Lots of back and forth as well. Nothing's been too one-sided.
Yeah, I have to agree. And we had this amazing moment where 6-0 had a puzzle, lethal puzzle, that I'm like, after we finish the cast, I'm just going to do my math and spend 2 hours figuring it out. or probably just go on Reddit. I'm sure somebody already had it, if it's it was lethal or not. Or what was the sequence? But it was a really cool day, and we had a lot of interesting matches overall. And a great top 4 as well, super stacked. And tomorrow, guys, we'll have the top 4 play. We have at least... Well, we actually have 4 matches, because we need to decide who goes to the final, and then we need to decide who is third, because third, being third, you still get the money, and being fourth, you don't. So probably the match which will be the third, fourth place will be one of the most important ones, where you end up in the money or you don't and get eliminated. So
it's $1,500 for third place. I mean, you can walk away from this tournament after you've invested this time playing in the group stages, even in this single elimination bracket, and you could walk away with nothing at this point. There is that could still happen. So you would want to walk away with something after being so invested. So I think that third place match is going to be great.
Absolutely, absolutely. And this is $10,000 overall. So big thanks to sponsors. Shout out to sponsors for giving us an opportunity to cast and to have this amazing tournament with so many top tier players. But for today, that will be it. So, Aqua, any final words to close the day?
just some great play from all players. Especially liked seeing 6-0 and Tice go at it there. I mean, the Sludge Belcher animation kind of a bite in 6-0 there. But overall, I think everyone played really well. And we have both the World Champion and the Europe's Champion left in the tournament. So they could be the dream final of Osaka Tice available to us. So we'll have to see what tomorrow brings.
Oh man, I really want to see a rematch with those guys playing. Whenever they play, it's so much fun. But thank you so much for watching, guys. It was amazing having you, and it was an absolute pleasure casting with you, Aqua. So yeah, that will be it for today. And see you guys tomorrow, same time. Let's see who will be our champion.